really excited for our conversation today. This is my last workshop after a really awesome month of 6 workshops thus far. We have one more from Negrafica on Tuesday. But so today, because it's my last one, I have something very special planned for you and a very special guest joining us. I've been really excited to share this surprise with you today, which is 2 parts. One is we have a really incredible guest. Adilia Caravaca Zúñiga is one of the wisest, smartest people I know, with a long history of activism and understanding the world's problems. And she's about as close as you can get to a holy soul walking among us. So I couldn't be happier that she's with us. Hello, Adilia, bienvenida. And second, our format today is completely different from what we've been doing. My plan for today is to match the theme of decoloniality, which entails decentering my perspectives and experiences, those of a white Latin American, light skin. You know, I appreciate Rosa Clemente's idea that identifying as white centers whiteness and is a form of anti-blackness. So when I say that I identify as white, it's a means of recognizing my privilege. But as a white, light-skinned Latin American man living in the United States with US citizenship status, I want to decenter my voice and my experiences and my perspectives. And what I want to do is make this about you, make this space about you and about our guests. So I'll invite you all to actually turn on your audio and your video so that you can be just as much as part of the discussion as anyone else. But let me say a few words. I'll introduce Adilia, and then we'll open up the floor almost the entire conversation. From the outset of this program, my purpose has been to instigate meaningful, multivocal discussions in which we purposely interrogated whiteness, right? And of course, the problem isn't just being a white person, but rather how our work tends to reflect whiteness and a way of thinking and being with the world. I take my cue from men like Paulo Freire and Arturo Escobar about how to be a man, a Latin American light-skinned man, and divest from whiteness and build critical solidarity, taking risks to, you know, divest myself from whiteness and divest myself from patriarchy as a Latin American man with privileges, and to develop an anti-racist ethos as a privileged person in relation to Black and Indigenous peoples of the Americas and of the world, and as a person of the Global South, who is also has a different kind of relationship with Eurocentric and Anglocentric worlds of academia and the dominant forms of knowledge production, for example. So this was the intention of the program from the beginning, to build a permanent space that would center marginalized and Global South perspectives in every aspect, in our readings, in the content of the lectures that I gave, in the stories and works that I helped to highlight in those spaces, and more than anything, in the multivocal conversations that we had with the guests that we invited to this space. I also want to go further and know how to make space and step back from it, to make a space and also know how to step back, set it up for success, use my privileges to create it, but also know how to leave it, right? And how to leave it in good hands, how to let it be without me, a space that will remain here and flourish for a long time, which I'm really proud of, where I'm only the first, but by no means the last. So in that spirit, what I wanna do is practice what I preach today, and I will listen more and talk less. I do have a million things to say, but it's more important to, as a white person, take a supportive role and be on the sidelines while covering a theme like today's, mostly because I'm very critical of the way this word decolonization has become appropriated and abused and commodified by the same white supremacist, Eurocentric, Anglocentric, capitalist structures, by white people, by the upper classes, even white people in the Global South or white men from the Global South who now work at really fancy, expensive, elitist institutions in the Global North with cozy professor positions and salaries. That's the kind of system that we're trying to unsettle, to turn on its head with this program. So I want to use my advantages to create this program, but also to not reproduce those same practices and know how to step away. So it's not that I don't have anything to say, but rather that I believe that the best way to study decolonization is by centering the voices and experiences of Black and Indigenous peoples today. So that's one of the messages that I'll leave you with in this whole program. I hope that that came across clearly. In order to decolonize our spaces, we don't need to romanticize the pre-colonial past. We need to center the voices of the most marginalized people today, particularly Black and Indigenous people, particularly Black and Indigenous women or Black and Indigenous trans and queer and two-spirit people, giving them the space. Even if, you know, we think that we're saying the right things, it's more important to just decenter our voices. And I also want this conversation to live up to its principles, which means opening the space for your experiences, for everybody in the audience. And what better time to do it than under a focused conversation about a world in crisis and our possible futures. And we'll come up with some answers to these difficult questions together. Not conclusive ones, but just ones that move us forward and build community in the process. To break the ice, to warm us up, and to get you into the conversation, I want to start with some questions for you. For these questions, you can draw your answer, you can make a word cloud among concepts and connect them, right, with your pen. You can make a list of words, you can just channel your answers however you want into a poem or a song, or just write them down however you want. And you don't have to share your answers if you don't want to, that's fine. This can be just for you. But if you're okay with it, we would love to hear what you have to say, what you're thinking, even if it's very brief. So here are my questions. My first question for you, and I hope you have something to write this down or you're at least just thinking about it, but what keeps you up at night? What keeps you up at night? What makes you lose sleep? That's the first one. Take a few seconds to think about it. It's just a warm up. Okay, my second question is, what gives you hope? Where do you draw inspiration? What keeps you going when the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer? Millions of people die every year from lack of access to resources, and we have more wealth than we've ever had. The capitalist system is extracting more resources than ever. More places are becoming contaminated, affecting particularly Indigenous and Black women and girls. What gives you hope in these contexts? It's important to talk about that. Next, what does decolonization mean to you? What does it mean to you to de-link from colonialism? How do you practice unlearning and de-linking from colonial power in terms of white supremacy, in terms of patriarchy, in terms of classism and elitism, in terms of geographic supremacy, right? The global north versus the global south, et cetera. How do you practice unlearning oppression and delinking from colonialism? So keep thinking about these questions and feel free to add your answers to the chat or let us know as soon as we all turn on our videos, you can share your answers, but keep thinking about them as we go. I just wanna do a couple more questions to warm up. I wanted to play a fun game with you. I wanna ask you, and anyone can turn on your audio and let us know, but let's play a game. Here is a Twitter post, a tweet from The Federalist, which is kind of a right-wing organization in the United States. It says, men were made for violence. It's part of why they were created. And the image, let me just describe it very briefly. It is for an article link. And the image is a young boy, it looks like, with his father, because it says men. Wearing camouflage and holding an assault weapon from a war context. And the headline just basically says men were made for violence. So let me ask you, how many types of violence can you spot here? And let me get a couple of answers. Feel free to turn on your microphones and let us know. Or let us know in the chat. How many types of violence do you spot here?
Violencia emocional. Violencia emocional o psicológica.
Violencia emocional o psicológica. Psychological or emotional violence. Yeah, interesante. Lilia, dinos un poquito más. ¿A qué te refieres? Say a little bit more.
Es exponer a un niño a ese concepto, ¿verdad? De cierta forma de patriotismo, ¿verdad? Un arma implica atentar contra una vida o potencialmente quitar la vida a otra persona, ¿verdad? O a un ser viviente, o puede ser un animal o otras personas. Y el concepto o la interiorización de esa idea para un niño, no, o sea, yo siento que es ya en sí mismo una forma tremendamente violenta de enfrentarse a la vida, a su papel en la sociedad, ¿no? En confrontación con otros y sin la posibilidad de ver otras, muchas otras opciones, ¿verdad? O sea, el vínculo papá-hijo en todo ese proceso está vinculado a eso, en lugar a tantas otras cosas que podría desarrollar esos vínculos de cercanía entre un padre y un hijo. Por citar algo.
Excelente. Okay, so Adelia just said this is emotional and psychological violence because this is a weapon of killing, and to expose a child to something like this, to expose a child to killing, is reproducing a lot of the problems that we have internalized, that we have psychologically internalized, or been taught about the role of violence and maleness and nationalism, she brought up in particular. No sé si me perdí algo de lo que decías. Voy a anotar mejor. But
básicamente está así.
It's an attempt against life. This was the most important thing that stuck with me about what Adelia said. It's an attempt against life.
Pero también es una forma muy terrible de relacionarse el padre y el hijo, es decir, de establecer ese vínculo entre ellos dos alrededor de esa idea, ¿verdad?
Yeah, and to establish that link between a father and a son through this kind of violence is such a violent idea, such a destructive way of building that relationship between a father and son. Yeah. And anyone else or anything else? Feel free to join in. Okay, so seeing none, I'm going to move on just to so we can open the conversation. But here's one way to think about it. Bell Hooks said, white supremacy has taught white men that all people of color are threats irrespective of their behavior. That all people of color are threats. Que todas las personas de color son amenazas, sin importar su comportamiento. Capitalism has taught him that at all costs, his property can and must be protected. El capitalismo les enseña a los hombres que a todo costo la propiedad debe ser protegida. And patriarchy has taught him that masculinity has to be proved by the willingness to conquer fear through aggression. Y el patriarcado nos enseña que la masculinidad tiene que ser comprobada por nuestro deseo o nuestra capacidad de conquistar al miedo por medio de agresión, tomar agresión cuando nos sentimos inseguros. So that's one way to think about all these forms of violence, right? Women, especially minoritized women, become outlets for male power expressed through violence, aggression, domination, and not only from their husbands or their intimate partners or their family members, but from the state itself, which embodies militarized masculinity. El Estado es una encarna. Forma corporal. Perdón?
Encarna.
Encarna, gracias. El Estado encarna la masculinidad violenta y militarizada. Okay, so next I just have one more question. This is the most interesting one, and I want you folks to participate in this. What do you think connects these cases? And let me explain what's on the screen really quickly. These are two images. On the left is an image of Tarana Burke, who is the creator of the Me Too movement. Tarana Burke is la creadora del movimiento Me Too, o yo también, marching with other women. The second image is of women protesting against extractivism, I believe in Guatemala, in the Global South, let's say. I think it's in Central America. But so what connects these questions, the Me Too movement and extractive protests or anti-extractive protests or extractivism? What do you think connects these two images? ¿Qué es lo que conecta estas imágenes? ¿Qué piensan? What do you think? Anyone? We're shy today. This is why I wanted to do a warm-up. Okay, just so we can move on, or let me make a little bit more time, 20 seconds. What do you think connects these things? Okay, I think some people are writing in the chat. I can't see it from my screen right now. But let me just say, during my research in Peru, a campesina leader, Natalia, por favor, please, go ahead, adelante. Can you turn on your audio?
Hi everyone. Actually, Michael, I'm also dealing with the cold. So let's see how well you can hear me. I did want to mention that somebody in the chat wrote, Brandon Ramirez, humanity, everyone is dealing with the same universal human struggles. I totally agree. Also, I met Michael in Peru doing my PhD research. And in that work, I make a similar connection about how the exploitation of the land and the violence, basically extractivism and extractive governance of the territory is connected to violence, gendered violence on women's bodies. So there's in my work, I draw this very clear link about how this colonial model that comes from a Anglo-Euro scientific white supremacist vision of the world looks both at the land and actually exerts its power on the land in the same way that it exerts power over women's bodies. And so in many places, the struggle against extractivism, against these capitalist models of governance, these heteropatriarchal capitalist models of government are tied to the liberation of women's bodies, right, from gendered violence.
Excellent. Yeah, that's exactly it. Beautifully said. Yeah, it's funny that you mentioned Peru, because what I was going to say in response to the comments that came in is that one way to put this is what a campesina leader told me in Cajamarca, which is where we met in the Andes in Peru and northern Peru, is mi cuerpo es mi territorio y mi territorio es mi cuerpo. My body is my territory and my territory is my body. There is no separation between my physical self and the land that feeds me, from which I'm nourished, that it kind of envelops my sense of being in the world, my cultural kind of system of making meaning of existence. All of this is the same thing. And so violence upon one and the entitlement that allows men to take violence upon, for example, women's bodies, is the same entitlement of extractive capitalism to make violence upon the earth, right? If that makes sense. Es la misma violencia, mi cuerpo es mi territorio es mi cuerpo. There's no difference. Does anybody else want to jump in before I move on?
Tal vez muy breve.
Sí, por favor.
Michael, me encantan las dos imágenes que están con una gran presencia de mujeres, obviamente, la Me Too, bueno, pero la otra es una, digamos, es una lucha que involucra más, pero son también las mujeres que están al frente, ¿verdad? De la lucha por la vida, contra el extractivismo, por las defensas de las tierras comunales, ahí presentes, ¿verdad? Entonces, este liderazgo tan notable de las mujeres en las comunidades, me parece que es interesante aquí, que ha sido un movimiento más desde las comunidades, el otro es un movimiento más de gente joven y clase media, predominante, aunque no exclusivamente, pero que tienen en común que son mujeres.
Excelente. Yeah, so what Adilia said is that it's really interesting and noticeable how women are at the front line of both these struggles, even though the Me Too movement in a lot of parts of the world, especially in the US, but even in Latin American countries, has been marked as a more middle-class concern of middle-class women, whereas the fight against extractivism is more of the comuneros, of the campesinos, of people who live in communal life, in defense of communal life, communal ways of being with the land, rather than just private kind of self-serving means. And that it's really interesting that women are at the front of the fight for life on both cases, right? That this is very interesting, very noticeable, and how, there are like these connections despite the kind of like class differences between these movements. Anyone else? Okay, so I'll move on. I want to recommend you just some readings that are really insightful, readings that my students have found valuable in my environmental justice classes, but I share them here just to kind of turn our gears and get our conversation going. Feel free to come back to this slide when these chats go up online, but especially check out the report, Violence on the Land, Violence on Our Bodies, which is on the top right, from the Women's Health Alliance and Native Youth Sexual Health Network. With all of this in mind, I wanna open up the floor to our conversation and introduce our special guest. Oh, I have one more slide with recommended readings and authors. Please do check out these two books, Perspectivas de Coloniais and Feminismos a la Contra in Spanish and Portuguese. And know that these authors have written in English, Portuguese, Spanish, in many other languages. The work has been translated, so please check them out. Mainly serve as a moderator as the questions come, but let's open up the floor. What do you want to know more about? And so I'll ask you to turn on your audio, turn on your video if you want to. I understand some people don't want to, that's totally okay, but at least join us in this discussion through the chat if you don't mind. And let's open up the conversation. So let's get into it. What possibilities do you see for decolonial futures? ¿Qué posibilidades ves para los futuros descoloniales? And how do you think people in different contexts can be part of that? ¿Y cómo pueden participar diferentes personas en diferentes contextos? ¿Qué le dirías a alguien que no sabe dónde empezar? What would you tell someone who doesn't know where to start?
I think it's very important because academia and all our culture is so colonialized, obviously. So it's very important to resource some very important materials, like you were sharing some of the, you know, the colonial readings by feminists, which is very important. I will mix English and Spanish, if you don't mind. I always recommend, because to me, it was a very important to understand a lot of the impact of colonialism in people's mind in psychology, is the famous and always good to read and reread again. It's Fanon with a black skin, white mask, because I think understanding the impact of internal colonialism is so important, because it's so vital for our work in whatever space we are, intellectual, academic, social, domestic, even interacting with other people in our homes, is to understand how psychologically we are impacted and affected by colonialism, and by how it undermines our own sense of worth, self-esteem, and being able to feel proud of our roots, of our color, of our everything, of our beings, our culture, our manifestations, is so vital, and how it really helps communities to be united and have this sense of union and able to defend what they have, you know, in terms of their environment, everything. Their own richness, everything. So I will try to do exactly what you did, share very valuable resources that are, you know, written by women, written by people of different cultures, colors, all around the Big South, you know, Asia, Africa, Latin America. And very importantly, you know, what's been written by women, you know, and also young women. A lot of amazing things that are being produced, you know, in all different kinds of manifestations. And I'm really, really happy to see in this fora all these young faces of women, you know. And it's always very interesting how, you know, women are predominant in numbers whenever this kind of forums. So I welcome and very happy when I find men involved. And one of the ideas that I want to leave in the men participating here is, we love when you're feminist among feminists, but I think it's always important and challenging to be feminist men among men, you know, because that's what we need a lot. So it's very important for you guys to to be able to do that in the smartest way you can, you know, but to be heard, and it's a very valuable support that we can have. I will try to make sure answers so that we can continue the conversation and have more questions. Okay.
Excellent, thank you so much. Yeah, I love that. Men being feminist, not only as a performance, right? But also when no one's looking, when you're not surrounded by cameras, for example. Yeah, so we've got some questions here. Victoria just asked me about the second image. It was an image of anti-extractive protests. Does anybody else wanna ask a question? Please feel free to turn your mic on and you can ask anything you want. Oh, Brandon, please.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for hosting this space. It really means a lot. Finding it so out of the blue, I know I mentioned that, but you know, it's divine timing, I think. But I wanted to ask a question just kind of based off of, like, you know, recently I've been talking to my friends about a lot of stuff, you know, that I've heard at, you know, past panels like this and in, you know, other spaces about, and they tell me, wow, these ideas, you're crazy. Like, this is the way the world works. This is the way things are supposed to be, and the only way they can be. And it just, you know, it's very striking that a lot of things that we think is, like, you know, common sense, a lot of people think are crazy. And I've heard that so many times to my face. So I guess it's kind of a really broad question and kind of convoluted in a way, but, like, what do you think we should be doing? Should we be trying to convince everybody that, like, hey, this is common sense, as I'm sure we all think, right? Or should we be trying something else? I just be interested in the perspectives. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Yeah. La pregunta es cómo ser, ¿no? Si vale la pena más un esfuerzo o otro tipo de esfuerzo, si tenemos que convencer a todos, todas y todos de que el sistema que estamos viviendo no tiene sentido o si podemos utilizar nuestro tiempo y nuestros esfuerzos de otra manera. If we can use our time differently than convincing people.
Anyone else? Should I try a little bit of?
you can try and you know, if other people want to jump in.
I don't have any final answers for anything. It just thoughts that comes to my mind as I hear some thoughts or questions. One of the things that we're hearing him hearing that question is, I know it's a very controversial historical character, Gandhi, but a lot of his good ideas, you know, we can recover or, you know, rescue. And one is this idea of a construction, building, brick by brick. I can't remember. So you cannot necessarily convince with a big project or something already finished, design, or, you know, try to destroy what there is to install something totally new that nobody knows what it is, how it looks like, but in trying on daily efforts to act and to build what we think should be alternative, what there is that we don't like, that we think is destructive, you know? And it's, so we do this building while there's still the system that we don't like pervades, so still is there, but we are creating something different, you know, and we cannot do that individually. So the idea of organizing with a, you know, like thinking people, you know, the people that we can share some thoughts, ideas, projects, and do what we can do where we are, you know. This is this kind of building the alternatives, you know, be the change we want to, you know, to cause. And I don't think it's very worth it, although it's important to convince others, you know, at least in part, but it's also very important to act and to show what we propose, you know? So it's this idea to live by the example or to teach by example, you know? It's so important in domestic life, and it's so important in the communities, it's important at the workplace. a little by little, I guess, we can make this kind of little revolutions. And, yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Anyone else? What other questions? Brandon says, thank you so much. Muchas gracias. Daeli, please, por favor.
Eu queria falar. Eu tô sem a opção de levantar a mão aqui.
Okay.
Eu queria fazer uma pergunta
aqui. I'd like to ask you a question. Do Brandon. That goes against the question raised by Brandon. Sometimes I read some references. Thinking especially about the indigenous communities. I'm thinking. How the native people. How they articulate themselves to still live outside colonization and fight the colonization. How is native people, for example, in Brazil, they still fight to remain their culture. And how can we get out this Eurocentric thought process and apply it to our daily lives, in our society, in our communities? How not to only subvert the values, but to add to these values? How the European thinking and the religious thinking, especially Christianity, is heavily impacting the way we live and how we can open doors, open windows to different ways of thinking. So understanding the colonial process is about understanding plurality. And this is very strong within the Quilombola communities in Brazil, the native communities in Brazil. They really raise this flag daily in their communities already.
And I think it has to do with Brandon's question also about, you know, whether we need to convince people and articulate the argument or just kind of like do it and practice it in autonomous spaces. One question I always think about is whether, oh, and Natalia, please, por favor.
Okay, but if you want to finish your question, that's also fine. Thank you so much for these great questions. I think one of the things also living through the global COVID-19 pandemic that has just like resonated with my work and also with my own orientation in life and my feminist praxis has been looking at how, for example, in Peru and also in the US, there are similarities in how people have responded to the pandemic. And I'm talking specifically in Peru about the olla común, which is the communal pot, but in many other contexts, it can be interpreted as mutual aid. So how mutual aid has emerged out of people's struggle to deal with what it will always be the insufficiencies and the violence of living in a capitalist hate, but you know, like if we just want to name that big overarching global system, you know, capitalism. And I want to like speak to what Dayeli's, you know, reference to indigenous ways of knowing and being, and to some indigenous theorists who talk about refusal. So not so much about resisting capitalism, but to refuse altogether the terms in which, right, it's asking how to live, right? So people are starving, right? And not to mention all the other like medical needs that aren't being met, but in Peru, right? And in, here in the US, people are like, you know, they're refusing what capitalism, the individualism that it's required of people, and they've come together to feed each other and to create like neighborhood food pantries and like community refrigerators where people can just go in and like you know, get groceries if they don't have any food at home. In Peru, the olla común, actually, I know of it from the anti-mining movement and resistance in Cajamarca, which was a part of the movement practice. Everybody ate together. Everybody would contribute a potato, some corn to feed the entire, you know, the movement. But during the pandemic, in the cities, so in urban settlements, but not necessarily in the formal settlements, but in informal settlements, people have helped each other, you know, put food on the table by just handing out free food. And this has been through informal networks, right? So I think thinking about refusal, right? But also how we can enact these changes, like how we can refuse what seems like it is unchangeable in our daily actions if we practice it, right? Like it is a decolonial practice that we can participate in what is seemingly a small way, right? Like to participate in our mutual aid networks. So those are, I think that for me brings it all together, both Brandon and Dayeli's questions.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you so much. Yeah. Anyone else want to jump in on that point or make a new question? Or Dayeli does respondo a sua pergunta? Más o menos.
Yo creo que es una pregunta interesante y que seguramente podríamos estar respondiendo desde distintos puntos de vista, todos en distintos momentos para seguirla pensando. Una de las ideas que ella planteó, según yo la entendí, es, bueno, hay experiencias de resistencia, de hacer cosas diferentes, ¿verdad? Pero ¿cómo hacemos para que se vean tanto en la academia? O sea, ella decía, no sé si la mejor traducción, yo le entendí, how we can see plurality in our daily life. How we can appreciate important resistance efforts that are there in so many ways in the daily resistance to many things. I mean, we cannot romanticize poverty or ways of life that are basically because people just don't have the resources. It doesn't mean that they don't want to have what people in the outside world or the outside their communities have. Is how we can make what humanity in history has been able to achieve and make it accessible without making them feel that they are getting charity, you know, or they are less because they have other wealth, so that we can kind of share what they can give in terms of their knowledge about how they relate with nature, how they are able, for example, to take care of nature, which is a wealth of knowledge there. We can, you know, have this, I don't know, it's not the word that I like the base, the most trade, but it's kind of an exchange. You know, we can nurture from their knowledge. We can share some material things that they have been denied because of their history of isolation, because isolation was a survival mechanism, yeah? But it doesn't mean that they have to be excluded. Maybe some of the things we have, they don't care, but many of the things we have outside, you know, that are material, maybe useful for whatever they have in their communities. So sharing, but not charity. I don't know, it's a basic thought that I would like and enjoy and integrate their vision or their plurality or appreciate it and treat it with respect it's so often, I mean, even from progressive people, you know, it's so often to hear very dismissing expressions against indigenous communities, even from people that you think are nice, and they have all these prejudices, you know, about, you know, they want everything for free or stuff like that. You know, it's awful. All the things, you know, common phrases, you know, that are so stopping this kind of thinking, you know, or prerogatives, and prerogatives, not pejorative expressions against communities, is part of, you know, the daily contributions we can do. And if we have a situation of privilege in the academia, in a radio program, in, you know, in different spaces, you know, we can have maybe occasions in which we're able to make visible, you know, how they resist, how they sing, how they express their, you know, their arts, the way they communicate, the way they deal with things, the way they solve problems. So it's just, you know, use whatever resources we have and take these opportunities. And in our daily life, you know, be militant, be adamant about stopping certain things, certain language or narratives that are very discriminatory, and be able to highlight the greatness that there is also, you know, without romanticizing, but you know what I mean.
I love that. That's excellent. Yeah, being militant and interrupting the micro games and then moving on to the macro games, right? Because when we see a moment of, for example, racialized harassment on the bus, it's really important as people of privilege to stand up and get in the way. But then when you think about something as big as the external debt that drains hundreds of billions of dollars out of the global South and into the global North every year, then how do we, you know, because like mutual aid is one thing. We need to develop autonomous communities and be willing to defend them militantly, unapologetically. But then when we get to the big questions of like the external debt or the arms trade, how do we escalate from autonomy and mutual aid in our everyday practice to something as big as that? And Natalia says, also acknowledging that Indigenous people are our neighbors, friends, colleagues, etc. They are part of our communities. Yeah, that's excellent. Does anybody else have any thoughts? What does it mean to be militant? What else do you want to talk about? It also harkens back to something Delio was saying last week, because I introduced how there are many ways of kind of thinking about social change at the macro level, at the micro level. And I said that taking institutional power and state authority, right? Running for office like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and saying the right things, pushing against the grain, you know, the entire system is working against somebody like her, but we need people in those positions. But I also know a lot of my friends in academia think, no, we can't be playing with the state anymore. This is a waste of resources. So I think this kind of harkens back to what Brandon was saying, what Ellie was saying, what Natalia and Adilia just said, is this question of, do we want to focus only on, do we need to convince people who disagree with us, who are mean and violent to us, or do we just want to focus on forming autonomous spaces, or do we need to kind of fight in the public arena and contest elections and win the public debates? Maybe that's one way to rephrase it and think about it. I don't know if that helps, but other people, please jump in. What do you think about that, Adilia? Should we not be focused on the state and focus on autonomous communities, or do we need to focus on every kind of strategy as much as possible? What do you think?
At least we should vote. There are situations in which, you know, the lesser evil, you know, we need to use. I mean, it's a conquer of humanity, you know, to have democracy is very limited, and you know, it's just voting is very limited, but it's important to do it. So I don't dismiss that, although, you know, I don't have that many hopes many times, because the structure and the way, you know, political parties work. and it's very important what we do at community level, but you know, we shouldn't dismiss, you know, power is power, resources, allocation of resources, how situations are managed. And that's what we have. I mean, there is an organization and a structure that, you know, we can try to change. And there is a, you know, there's a lot of discussion among feminists that we should, you know, destroy the enemy with the same tools of the enemy. And, you know, it's very radical thinkers against that. But I may not be that radical, if you want. I mean, I think it's important to use the citizens' rights that have taken so much of people, you know, of peoples to conquer, to be able to exercise the right to vote, the right to participate, and at least have this fora to, you know, raise the messages and the voices and be able to bring initiative and at least take part of the resources, the financial, the, you know, the, what there is, which doesn't mean that that's the only thing. I mean, I think that will be totally deceitful to think that that will change anything. We need to work in our communities and to, you know, not be so trusting of whatever the system has to offer, and always be vigilant to, you know, and active in bringing up initiatives and denounce what needs to be denounced. So, but I think we cannot just leave totally any fronts. We need to use what we can, and there will be times we need to focus more in one area and other times in others, you know, but use whatever fronts we can, right?
I love that. Yeah, as long as that battlefront exists, we cannot cede it. That's how I think of it. Like, when there's somebody like Donald Trump, you know, even if I disagree with the Democratic Party or I don't think that the Democrats are really a force for change, we have to stop somebody like, you know, fascists and win those elections. We can't afford to just say, oh no, that's not a battlefield on which I want to give that space to the fascists, right? We have to fight them on every level. I wanna encourage May, Cindy, Ilana, Efrain, Karen, what other questions do you have for us? What other questions do you have for Alilia and for Natalia and Jeffrey? What else do you want to talk about? I know May's thinking. She's thinking. I can see it in her face.
Eu tô na verdade pensando. Pode falar em português?
Pode.
Eu tô, na verdade, pensando...
I'm constantly thinking about the first questions that Michael raised in the beginning of the presentation, mainly about what keeps me up at night. I believe that what keeps me up at night is the fear for the future. Because I'm a young Black woman living in Brazil, woman living in Brazil, and be during the pandemic, thinking about the future, especially among so many drastic news in my country. Daily also, like today, I was trying to rest a little bit, but I'm constantly bombarded with how much the state wants to exterminate us, wants to end our lives and fight against us. I was trying to distract myself and rest, but I ended up seeing some news that I heard about a young woman, a Black woman that was killed and she was pregnant. That really touched me. It was very overwhelmed. So a question I have to ask, how can we think about alternatives to raise hope when we are confronted with so many bad news daily? It's more about sharing my experience.
Okay, I added a quick translation to the chat. Please, Nayeli, Por favor. Desculpa.
Sobre o que a Mayara falou, sobre pensar...
About what Mayara asked. About strategies of hope, raising hope. I think about... That's very, very related to the last question. How can we unlearn the oppression and practice decolonial practices? I also always based myself on my interactions with the people that are equal, my peers, that there are the strengths I find among my peers. Here we have a, we call in Brazil the quilombamento, the quilombo process, when you connect people to give you strength, to create strategies, resisting strategies to solve a problem. So this quilombamento, this quilombo practice is a end that gives me hope, is a pathway of hope. I think it's a strategy to think about the colonial practice, to bring in your peers, to invite people to be by your side and stand by you. And based on this strategy of getting people together and adding to their forces, And it's exactly this the source of Negráfica, the collective Negráfica, and I'm getting touchy and overwhelmed by this because this is exactly the process. So I start sharing my experiences with Mayara and other girls, and we saw that we have a voice that can get to people and we can express this to other people and we can share these experiences.
Natalia, yeah. Adelante.
I wanna also add, because this reminds me of a conversation I had recently with a Mexican colleague. We were talking about about hope and about sometimes the difference between feminism in the US or in Anglo academia and feminism in the global South, and hope as like something like a different kind of register that does sometimes doesn't, it isn't what hope and love maybe that isn't found in some, in like the ethos of global South feminisms. So she was talking about some work by I'll have to get her citation, but what she was saying was that in the global South a lot of the feminism is being driven by hate in the sense that it's resisting the hate that comes from patriarchal racist capitalist systems. And I was saying that I find a lot of value in Jose Esteban Muñoz's work on queer scholar and who talks about like critical hope, how we can still be hopeful, but in a critical way and think about a critical utopia, and that like we can find the possibility of an alternative of a critical utopia in the present. And I think there are points of connection between the idea of a critical hope and also a movement that is coming out of in resistance to hate, right? To all that violence. And so I think that, I mean, sometimes, and to bring it back to refusal, I think even the possibility of finding joy in our day-to-day, in like the small moments when we can, to really like be present for that joy, because in that joy we're refusing to be, you know, to be silenced, we're refusing to be like, you know, killed. Like, that's not what the system wants for our communities of color, you know, for our various gendered communities, our various marginalized communities. So even being able to just like be present for our joy whenever it comes, like it might come at the most unexpected moment, but yeah, I think, I don't know, maybe there's hope in that, but I'm also trying to figure it out too.
Adilia, ¿quieres? Do you want to add anything?
No, es que ahorita no recuerdo el autor, pero en este libro que me imagino que en algún momento lo habrás recomendado, de la tsunami, una de los autores, una de las autoras, bueno, una trans, hablaba de radical tenderness, ¿no? As a way to resist the violence. I mean, if there is any sector in our oppressed group that has suffered, undergone violence, is the trans community. And she's sharing many of the experiences, and she uses this phrase of radical tenderness, you know, as a way of resisting. So, well, you know, it's always the idea, you know, hate that does not, I mean, the only way to eliminate darkness is through light, you know, and hate through love. And it's also always very important to keep it in mind. It doesn't mean that you stop being critical. So I thank you, Natalia, very much for bringing that up. I think it's very important in all these efforts to maintain joy and camaraderie and find the spaces for joy, for enjoying our companies, our sharing of knowledges and experiences. I mean, this meeting in these circumstances, you know, it maybe it had not occurred if we hadn't have COVID, but you know, this is one of the things, you know, we're using more of these resources and we don't have to plan a meeting, that we have to travel hours, you know, and we're able to see all these beautiful faces and hear all different kinds of thoughts and concerns and inputs. And I really like the comments of Natalia, keeping that in mind, you know. Be present for our joy. I'll keep that thought. Okay.
I love that. Yeah. I want to make sure we have only a few minutes left. If you haven't spoken today, please, now is the time. What questions do you have, or what answers did you write to the questions that we opened up with? Now is your chance.
I would like to ask you about what is the relationship with the economical model, the hegemonic economical model with our lives, our style of life. What is the impact that you can appreciate on it?
Yeah, excellent question. I have the same question, which is capitalism reduces you to individualism and individual choices. How do we break out of that? And Adilia also talked about this, how charity, la caridad, charity is not the solution, because this is a voluntary hierarchical relationship. That's not what we need. We need redistribution on a massive scale, land redistribution. Jeffrey's asking, how do we respond to capitalism without internalizing it, without becoming complacent? What do folks think? I had this question for you, Adilia, actually. I don't know if you have thoughts about it, but I was curious what you thought about it too.
About this question?
Yeah, about individualism and capitalism, and how do we build up so that we're not falling into, oh, just buy fair trade coffee, or, oh, you know, I don't know, things like that.
Well, it's... There is the idea, you know, local economies and helping smaller producers, you know. And I think, you know, it won't bring the big changes or redistribution, you know, but it's something that we can do individually on a daily quotidian base, which, you know, it doesn't mean that, you know, that we don't aspire, you know, we can don't try to reach larger changes in terms of distribution and, you know, how we prevent billionaires or huge companies to keep not paying taxes and, you know, and making things so hard and difficult for most people, you know, with wages that don't even reach the minimum. And, you know, I think, again, it's a long list of things of, you know, that we can do and ways in with which we can do our political activism, you know, art, you know, sing songs, manifesting in, you know, uniting with different sectors and be part, you know, strengthen, you know, use our voices, use our writing, you know, anything that we can do to try to, you know, contribute to changes where we can have a little bit of, even if little influence, you know, that can be added to others, you know, and be open to find your peers, you find people like you, like Daleli said, you know, finding all this process of finding the strengths to promote other ways of thinking or living, you know, in promoting changes, in changes in narratives. Thinking, writing is very powerful. Like I always remember, you know, because sometimes we all can do that, and a lot of times maybe we complain, but maybe we're not aware enough, and I, including myself, as self-criticism, you know, how powerful we can, you know, contribute in a powerful way when we write, you know, even if not a long book, but, you know, writing and expressing things with which other people can identify, you know. So, because of different circumstances of people, you know, women with different tasks every day, working, coming home and this and that, you know, but finding a little bit of space to write something or to help publicize what others write. Like I am in a women's peace organization. I have a retired friend and she likes writing, and I, you know, I help her, you know, even with some thoughts, mm-hmm. and we do something jointly, even if I don't sign it, but, you know, I help. So promoting ideas and changes in narratives can also be a powerful contribution, and promoting the art of young people, you know, so many wonderful things. And also these communities that are often isolated, you know, like our indigenous communities, and they may have a lot to share. So being able or open to reproduce and help to make diffusion of all of these efforts is part of resisting, you know, mainstream thinking and mainstream way of consuming and living our lives. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Arilia. I appreciate sharing the space with all of you, you sharing your time to be here. It just, yeah. It means the world to me, and it's where I find joy and hope. And I know that the future is in good hands, because there are people like you who want to make time out of their day to have these conversations. I know that the future will be bright. I'm really grateful for this chance to think through these difficult questions and engage with this problematic world with you together over the past weeks. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. It's been a tremendous honor. Please stay in touch. I wanna keep hearing about all of that you're learning and unlearning. I wanna keep in touch and you know, be useful to you if you find my work useful. I wanna recommend you texts and documentaries and things like that. I wanna hear your thoughts, see your art, check out your writing, et cetera. But feel free to just reach out if you wanna talk. I'll always be happy to listen. I'll be around. So I just wanna say, don't forget your history and don't forget your mission, and never stop dreaming and never stop fighting to build new possibilities, because you should trust yourself. You are ready and you are more capable than you know, and in your hands, when you're ready, the world will be bright. Thank you so much.